We have an unidentified flying object.
I'm Jack Osborne, and you're listening.
This is Nathan Hammay, and you're listening to.
I'm Richard C. Hoagland, and you're listening to.
I'm Art Bell, and you're listening to Dr. J Radio Live.
We have an unidentified flying object.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the truly internationally, globally syndicated show about the globe, speaking to you about the truth that you never hear, the truth that the mainstream media, that in the United States at least, is owned by five corporations, and I would not be surprised if those same five corporations own the entire world's media. But of course, our guest will get to say that soon. Now, right off the bat, you know this is an international show. Why is that? Because of my trusty co-host live in London in the studio at 3 a.m. Greenwich Mean Time, where it happens to be 7 p.m. Pacific time, where I am in the City of Angels. And this makes it really cool because normally I just tell people on the East Coast of the U.S. that it's 10 p.m. Eastern time, but that happens to be where our guest is. Now, let's just remind people why this is so important for you to understand. The fact that we are syndicating live, we syndicate on Late Night in the Midlands, PSN Radio, Pulse Radio, which is the newest one Johnny Webb brought to us, not to mention Deep Program Radio Network and our very own Coast to Coast PM Radio Network. And watch for that soon. We got lineups with cool people on. So far, we have Lieutenant Bob or Robert Weekend, who's going to be doing a weekly show, and Sean David Morton with his 5 days a week. And we have talks with other hosts, and soon it'll be a full-fledged other source for you guys to check out. News that belongs to every single one of you, because as our guest is about to tell you, what I think is the ultimate thing to for everyone to know is that essentially that there's not several conspiracies. There's only one real conspiracy, one lie. And when you think about it that way, it makes so much more sense than any other way, if you think, you know, because there really is just one lie, and all these other things are just connectors. Just connectors. So first, let me give a shout out to Johnny Webb in London, who's been awake literally to stay to start the show. It is now 3:06. Johnny, how you doing, brother?
Not bad, Dr. J, and looking forward to our next guest. I always enjoy listening to this gentleman.
And the reason I always, I'm sure you guys always want to know, guys and gals, may I say, we do have female listeners out there as well. I want to tell you the reason why I give you a few minutes talking without telling you who the guest is, so you can go on DrJRadioLive.com or any of the social media outlets and see who our guest is tonight. Well, now I've given you over 5 minutes to do so, so I might as well introduce him. He is the one, the only, I've already spoiled it for you, the one who leans the same way I do, that there's not a bunch of conspiracies, that there is just one big lie, the one, the only, Mr. Robert Morningstar. Robert, my friend, how you doing tonight?
I'm fine. Thank you for having me tonight. It's a very special night.
Now, when we resumed live shows last week, and the first two nights were purely on the topic I'm about to speak to you. The third night, Johnny wasn't there. It was a lot about, we were supposed to be with Preston Dennett with UFOs over Arizona's latest book, but instead we did a lot about abductions, but this topic crept in there anyhow. But I need to start off with this topic with you tonight, because where I'm living in the City of Angels, where you're living definitely in Manhattan next to the Trump Tower, and where Johnny is broadcasting from in his studio and living in London, these are three distinct places, two of them which are having massive protests that have never occurred in history. And then you have the outsiders looking in. That's why I love to hear Johnny's, every time a guest has something to say about the topics, that's why I love to hear his global interpretation and what, of course, the chat room said. So, Robert, why are people acting this crazy? Why are the people, I mean, I've been talking to a lot of people, and only, this blows my mind. Leading up to the election, I polled every single guest, either on the show or off the show, and most of the callers, most. And I said, who would you like to see as president? All guests, all but two, said Trump. The only two were clearly establishment politicians. One being the Democrat who lost against George Herbert Walker Bush in the 1988 presidential election. Governor Michael Dukakis, great guest, good friend of mine too, and he'll be on soon. The reason why he hasn't been on right away, as we agreed right after the election, is he's probably still soaking it up, and I wouldn't be surprised if he's joined in the protests. But he's going to be a stand-up guy and come out and say, whatever, we had our differences in the past, America's America, and the left and the right have to unite because it's the common soil. But you, my friend, happen to be living in a similar situation where I can't drive. Thankfully, we had some rain the other night, which essentially ended the protest for a time, but we'll see if they continue as people say through January 20th, as Donald J. Trump is sworn in as President of the United States of America. And may I add this, I'm sure you know about this, because she is a senator from here in California, United States Senator. As you know, everybody out there globally listening, we have 100 senators, one Democrat, one Republican, usually. Of course, now we have a Republican House, Republican Senate, Republican President, and pretty soon it'll be a Republican majority, SCOTUS, Supreme Court of the United States. The point being is you're supposed to have one of each party, but it doesn't usually work that way. Like, for instance, in California, they're both Democrat. But our Democratic Senator, Barbara Boxer, has put a bill forward for what's known as a California exit, very similar to Brexit. And what this would mean is they said it was already gaining momentum in the last couple of years, which blows my mind because I didn't really think they were collecting signatures for this. But they want to have this on the ballot in 2018. And if that wins, then they're going to have another vote about a year later to secede from the union. But in order to do that, you're going to need 3/4 of the other states to say yes, California can leave. So there's two topics I'd like to start with before we continue on with the other major stuff, of course, which is the assassination of JFK, which happens to be the anniversary, and of course we Trump and the IPCRUS filing of United States,
yes.
Yeah, exactly. So tell me about the two things. What do you think about Calexit as well as the Trump demonstrations? Because how far are you from Trump Tower?
I think it's pretty harebrained, to be honest with you. Where would California go, you know? What would they engage in? How would they handle their borders? You know, think about these things. I think California has to have the longest border when you consider the whole length of the Pacific coast, and then the cut inland, and then down the mountain ranges. That's a hell of a lot of border. How are you going to control that? I think it's a harebrained idea, and well, I think it's part of this programming, the culmination of 53 years of MK Ultra manipulation of the national mindset, and it has come to a culmination. And what I'm happy about this anniversary, you know, the November 22nd is never a happy anniversary, but I am happy tonight. Because I believe that after 53 years of struggle, the American public, the American consciousness has broken out of the grip of a Wizard of Oz form of mind control, which manipulated the population into either zombies or munchkins. And the zombies I see now in the aftermath of the Trump victory or the Trump triumph in the election is a byproduct, a toxic byproduct of this manipulation of the American psyche that has been ongoing since the day John F. Kennedy died. And the reason this is so important is that this is the residue, this is the leftover, the backwash of the poisoning, really the poisoning of the American mind and the American consciousness. So I think that the majority of Americans broke out, and I am celebrating the demolition of the MK Ultra mass media mind control apparatus that was engineered and built up over the last five decades in order to manipulate our thinking, our beliefs, and more recently and more sinisterly, our emotions. The remnant of disaffected Democrats who cannot accept the outcome of this election the way Republicans did accept the outcome of the last two elections, as unlikely as they seemed to have appeared, is a syndrome. It's a psychological malaise, a form. Some are mentally ill, some are literally. The ones who are going violent, killing cops, torching police cars, vandalizing and rioting and causing general mayhem, those people are mentally ill. The angry ones, the angry crowd is an emotionally disturbed crowd that has not come to grips with the fact that the emotions that they are feeling and channeling are not really their own. They have been programmed with emotional trigger memes that, and this has been over the period of the last many years, in particular the manipulation of the mass media by the Democratic Party and so-called progressives or leftists or communists, as I just prefer to call them outrightly, because communism is a snake that has been winding its body around the neck and throat, more like an octopus in recent years, that almost strangled America. And America has broken out of the grip of mass media mind control, and that's why I am celebrating this day.
Well, that is something I definitely want to talk to you about, because I don't know if you've watched the series on National Geographic. They had specific people. They had facing Saddam, facing Arnold Schwarzenegger, facing Pablo Escobar, facing Vladimir Putin. It's funny, though, when they were advertising this, they were advertising they were going to air a segment on facing Hillary. Of course, that never happened air. But I'm seeing at least what our mainstream media is telling us again and again, as you said, MK Ultra lies, is that he's essentially bringing the Iron Curtain down again. And before you answer that real quick, Johnny Webb actually, as a Londoner, has something to say to us about what's going on here, because this is what he wrote me is something that I didn't even know about.
Sure.
Comparing it to the news I'm watching. Go ahead, Johnny.
Well, yeah, over here in England, we're, you know, obviously we get sensitive news and issues sometimes get sort of chopped where we don't get all the information. But right now we're getting a lot of information coming in about the rally in Dakota, you know, Standing Rock, police attacking protesters with rubber bullets.
You're talking about the pipeline, right? The Indian,
yeah,
the African-American Indian.
Much headlines in America, but in England and in the West, it's all over the news, you know.
It comes up for about a 20-second, 30-second segment. It comes up, but nothing like 15 minutes or an hour on protests, you know, or longer.
Well, I just watched, you know, Jill Stein make a Facebook documentary.
Jill Stein, presidential electee?
Exactly, and she was talking about Standing Rock. She doesn't stand by the police or the private security firm that's holding up this this rally, you know, that's stopping, you know, well, in fact, the people are stopping these groups from making this fracking pipeline that will save the water for the North American Indians. Why isn't that mainstream media at the moment, you know, and why isn't Trump speaking about that? You know, I've got a lot of hope and faith in Trump, but he's very silent on this matter at the moment. And, you know, this is your first, second, and all your amendments, you know, being abused. Squashed. Right here. What do you think of that, Robert?
Yeah, answer well, that, and then I want to talk to you about the video that Trump released, which didn't address about things like locking up Hillary or the wall. But we'll get to that.
I'll tell you what I think of this. First and foremost, remember that this operation is being run by Obama. Okay. They're trying to paint with a broad brush that every wrong, every civil right that's being abused in this country today is the product of Donald Trump's election. But that standing rock, the Dakota Access Pipeline, is a project that Obama has been beating with a cudgel. It's Obama who is violating the civil rights of the Native Americans. It is Obama that has declared war on the Native American Sioux of North Dakota. That land belongs to them by treaty of 1851. It has always been their birthright and their homeland. And for them to force a pipeline through eminent domain, so-called eminent domain, through these lands is completely illegal, because basically that land is a foreign country. It is the homeland of the Native American Sioux, and they have invaded it. They have declared war. They have declared war on the Native Americans in order to snatch this patch of land. So that's the first thing. This is Obama's doing, all right? So any Democrats who want to go out ranting about the Dakota Access Pipeline against Trump, just remember, it's Obama who's sending in the federal troops to put down these protesters. Okay.
Gotcha. Exactly.
What else need I say? It's an act of war.
Correct.
Obama has executed an act of war on the Sioux Nation, trying to expropriate lands that were deeded to them by the treaty, ceded to them actually, or acceded to them by the treaty of 1851. Why are they not paying attention? Because the mass media is still controlled by this administration, and they are working with the Democrats to restore their credibility. They have been dashed. They have been bashed. They have been demolished. All of their polls were wrong. All of their statistics were misinterpreted. And now they're trying to distract and also retract and also reconstruct the polling industry. They know they are in their death spiral. Talking about the polling, let me tell the people a little bit about how CNN abused polling and rigged it. After the first debate, about 20 snap polls said that Donald Trump had won with anything, depending on the state.
Yes, like New Jersey, talk about 52, that. Thank you for 50, mentioning that. Yes.
Okay, 52, anywhere from New Jersey to New York to California to the Dakota. You went across the states, but in almost everyone except Maryland, Trump won by 52% to 75%. So I quoted five of those polls on my Facebook right away.
Now, why is it that California was called at 3 p.m. Eastern, noon Pacific time, hours before the polls closed?
We're still talking about the manipulation before the election. Okay. We're talking about the first debate. So CNN came out and said that 67% of the people said that Hillary Clinton had won. Yes. And on that night, I was on with Richard Hoagland on his show, The Other Side of Midnight, and he asked me, how can you explain that? I said, all the other polls say Trump won. They say Clinton won. But Richard, the first thing wrong is that they say that Clinton won 67% to 27%. But 67 and 27 doesn't add up to 100. It should be 33. The only way that that could be true, I said to Richard Hoagland, is that more Democrats watch CNN than Republicans do, and so their sample had to be skewed.
Exactly, okay? As if you took a Fox poll, which has more Republicans watching. So exactly.
Well, they try to balance it out anyway. But let me just tell you this. So CNN criticized the Daily Mail and the English papers for carrying those stories about the Snap poll and insisted on the 67%. So the Daily Mail came back against them and called them up and asked them about their poll. And then the Daily Mail the next day, instead of putting 5 polls, they'd listed 25 polls or so that all showed that Trump won. And they put in this paragraph. It says, we were contacted by CNN, and this is the English word, and CNN warned us that their poll was skewed in the favor of Democrats. Get this. This is the killer sentence. CNN warned us that the Democrats had a 26% advantage before the voting began.
Because that's how many more were watching CNN.
Wait. This is the killer. This is the killer about the misinterpretation of the statistics. So they admitted that they had a 26% advantage over Trump. That means, you know, if you have an even, it's 50-50. But to have a 26% advantage means that the thing was 76-24. Right? So out of every 100 people polled, mm-hmm. if they voted their party, it should have been 76-24.
Yes.
But it came out 67-27. And I said, holy mackerel.
They got a free 27 points.
He actually got 9% of the Democrats.
Well, let me ask you this. I know I mentioned to you this off air last night, that if you were to take a line and take it right down California, right down the middle, vertically, right, from all the way up to Sacramento and beyond to the border, past San Diego to Tijuana, right, where the Mexican border is, right? Mm-hmm. If the coastal community side would be all Democrat, but the eastern side, Fresno, those central states, would all be Republican. However, Los Angeles falls into the western side. But nonetheless, that would essentially be two completely different states because two different belief systems. You got the farmers on the eastern side of California or Central Valley, California. You have things that Trump was appealing to. And another thing, let me say this to you. This is what I think is so crazy. If California was called as a blue state, 55 delegates, by far the biggest state, it was called 7 hours before the polls even closed. Why is it that even till that morning that every single poll had an average of Hillary winning between 5 points and 9 points, yet LA Times was the only poll that said Trump was up 5 points? Now, one of my friends says he believes that it was something on LA Times' part to sort of scare the Democrats, saying, oh my gosh, Trump is ahead, so go out and vote Hillary. But so that's another thing to think about. But the point is every single poll had him down except the one that was the most liberal.
Well, actually, there were two. Rasmussen poll had him up 2%. Mm-hmm. But that poll was kept off the air by every news station. You really had to go and dig. And the irony is that they actually had Fox News did publicize that a couple of weeks before the election, and they brought in the original Joseph Rasmussen, who formed the company. He sold the company out 2 years ago to the mass media, mm-hmm. and he got on the air, and they were saying, well, how do you feel about this? Your own organization that bears your own name, Rasmussen Poll, that Donald Trump is going to win by 2%. And he says, well, I sold the company about 2 years ago, and I'm no longer connected with them, and I reject. I don't agree with their findings. I thought that was really the greatest irony.
Well, a lot of people were saying that. That's the
but
craziest
the LA
part.
Times was on the mark.
They were.
And that's the one, the only one I believe was the LA Times University of Southern California poll and the Rasmussen poll. And I said to everybody, look, they're lying, they're twisting, they're skewing. watching that guy Steve Kondracki on MSNBC going bonkers every afternoon trying to explain how all of the electoral votes added up for a
And it wasn't as if Trump won like three delegates over, such as the Gore and Bush 2000 vote.
Right.
This was 47 delegates. 317 is what Trump got when he needed was 270. So this was almost you could consider it a landslide. If you take away California's 55, I mean, the amount she got when she called the Trump supporters deplorable, that number is deplorable, what she got. And if you subtract California, it makes it even worse, the amount of delegates she got.
Speaking of subtracting California, I want to go back to the California exit.
Yes, Calexit
scheme. Listen, folks.
Because today's the first time I heard about
California,
this.
If California were to withdraw from the Union in a very short amount of time, it would be a part of China. That's all I got to say to you.
Interesting. That I never considered, but that would make sense because do you know that in 2015, and I'm sure the same number will be for 2016, who do you think is the number one home buyer in the state of California?
Well, I was just going to tell you, Obama has been selling California piecemeal to the Chinese
nationals
in order to pay off the
national
debt. Exactly. We owe them.
Yes.
Who owns Hollywood today?
Chinese.
It's the Chinese.
That's right. They own
folks,
everything.
Wake up.
Homes in Beverly Hills, Hollywood Hills, downtown L.A., Silicon Valley, you name it, all up and down California.
The same goes for Canada.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know that.
British Columbia is in the grip of Chinese business mafia. Panama is completely controlled by the Chinese. Right now, it's kept out of the news, but the Chinese have practically taken over Nicaragua and are building a sea level canal, which I believe is going to be an ecological disaster. Let me tell you, folks, anywhere that communist engineering kicks up some dirt, they ruin the environment. Right now, people are talking about global warming and the melting of the Himalayan ice caps. Or the Himalayan, the Himalayan mountaintops, the snows are melting away. That's not because of anything.
That's what I was going to say. What do you think about when Trump's response to global climate change or global warming, when he said it's called weather?
It is called weather.
Yeah,
it's
we have cycles,
space weather,
right?
Space weather. But let me tell you this: it's space weather combined with abominable terraforming and engineering. There is a large body of water in Central Asia, an enclosed ocean, you might say, like a great lake. It was called the Aral Sea. And this Aral Sea irrigated and gave water to all of Central Asia, and waters from the Aral Sea would evaporate and become clouds that would pass over the Himalayas and drop snow and keep the ice caps on the Himalayas. The Russians went in, the Soviets, I want to make a distinction. The Soviets are different than the Russians. The Soviets are the communists that took over in 1917, lasted to 1990.
After, Lenin.
Russia is that country in the process of social, economic, and moral
totalitarianism with Vladimir
moral
Putin.
Well, moral recovery is what they're trying
to do. Because in communism, Russia, right, the Soviet Union, what you had was atheism. There was no religion. But now you have churches galore.
Yes. But let me say this, finishing with the Aral Sea. What the Soviets did is they went down into the Aral Sea and they stole the water. They made a deal with...
ROC, you mean that water that was evaporated to the Himalayas?
No, it's no longer evaporating because they stole so much water from that sea to propel the textile industry that they built in southern Russia. They stole the water. They funneled it out of the Aral Sea into the north to go into Russia to propel their textile industry, and the level of the Aral Sea dropped 30 feet.
Jeez.
Okay? Now you want to hear something even worse?
Yes. Sadly, but yes.
Yes, sadly. Bill Clinton was going to do the same thing in 1996 and 97, selling waters from the Great Lakes to China.
But wasn't that already happening, as Governor Jesse Ventura said? Even though when he came on the show, that's not what we talked about.
But stopped it.
We didn't want toilet water.
Real scientists did the science and said, holy mackerel, if Clinton sells that much water to China in the next few years, the level of the water in the Great Lakes is going to drop 10 feet.
And we're going to have toilet water to drink.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's the greatest body of fresh water on the planet, the Great Lakes. It is one of our great national treasures and resources. And I thought it was criminal. And now, you know, if I said that in 1996, people said, oh, that's horrible, calling the president a criminal. But now that we know the criminality of the Clintons and the Clinton Global Initiative, it's easy to see. These people were out, they're globalists, they were out only for themselves, they're hardcore communists since their college days, and they are totalitarian. You know, the acts that they perpetrated during their administration, the Waco massacre, the Ruby Ridge slaying of Randy Weaver's wife and child and two children, because the Len Horiuchi, the FBI sniper, fired a shot that hit in one shot. That's the real magic bullet. It was terrible. He hit the wife and the baby with one bullet in Randy Weaver's case, right? The Mura building. The bombing of the coal by Osama bin Laden's group, and Clinton did nothing. Then they went in and devastated Yugoslavia for no really good reason. Yugoslavia was involved in a civil war, and the Clintons took it upon themselves to side with the Muslims, who were the terrorists and are the terrorists in the global jihad that is still going on. So the criminality of the Clintons is far from over.
That's right.
And even though Trump has demurred on the idea of pursuing her for the emails, that is the very important thing. He said, I am not contemplating pursuing her, an investigation on her emails. But that leaves the entire Clinton Foundation wide open for investigation. And given in good time, I'm sure that justice will be done. So
now,
stay in the union, will you?
Yeah.
I don't think you'll be allowed to. California will not be allowed. Look, we had a civil war.
They're not going to let it.
South Carolina, and then the southern states that followed said they wanted to secede. And
that's where you got the Confederate states and the Civil War.
Right. But now, as you say, it has to be approved by 3/4 of the states, and no 3/4 of the states are going to approve that.
It's
a harebrained, as I said, Barbara Boxer's idea is a harebrained idea. Where did she introduce that? She's a United States Senator. You telling me she introduced that in the U.S. Senate? Or is this a California resolution?
Oh, no. This is going to start in the U.S. On the ballot in 2018, right?
In California.
And
ballot.
Exactly. And if it reaches enough, if it wins on that ballot a year later in 2019, it'll be in some sort of federal ballot, unless it's 2 years in the next presidential cycle, where it'll be in the national ballot. But in order for it to win then, after it gets approved, you're going to have two things happening. They are going to require, this is federal law, that 75% or more of other states have to say, yes, California can secede, which, as you know, the number one economy is supposed to be U.S., which I don't know if it's true anymore, considering you have a billion more people living in China, and they are leading in industry right now. And California is the fourth largest economy standing on its own. So, mm-hmm. But I didn't want to mix these two up unless you think it's important. Now, as we mentioned at the beginning of the show, that this is the anniversary of JFK's death. Now, why have some people actually stated that Trump will be as great as a president as JFK because he's going to so-called clean out the swamps? And in that video he released, I think it was really cool what he did say, that he's putting term limits which will even apply to him, that anybody who is in any form of office and involved in anything in the federal government has to wait 5 years before they can become a lobbyist. And if they're international, say ambassadors or something like that, they cannot come back as lobbyists. They cannot, foreign lobbyists will be banned after their foreign politics are over. So I think the fact that he's already done that, I think it's kind of, putting some good term limits. But right. Then we also have to address the fact of two of the major things is everybody recalls at the Trump rallies, people saying, lock her up, lock her up. Now, personally, I think two things would happen. Obama, before he leaves office, if there's any sort of indictment to come down again on Hillary for a third time, and if Comey comes out for a third time stating that there's no evidence or the conclusion's the same and we're not going to proceed and send this over to the Attorney General, because people need to understand the president, yes, he can appoint a special prosecutor, but the president can't persecute. He can't just lock her up. Yeah, it's not going to happen that way. So I
don't think they mean to do it that way
either. Yeah, but no, at the same time, if you saw the way she looked a few days ago when she was essentially saying we have to accept that Trump is the new president, you do want to kind of feel sorry for her, but at the same time, she is a criminal in every way.
Yeah. There's no doubt about that.
So
the thing about this, it's a very slippery slope that Trump is walking. He made the promise, but he cannot appear to be vindictive. He's really got to let the law play itself out, and it's got to be up to the Congress to pursue it. She's in big trouble with the Senate Oversight Committees that were investigating her for Benghazi, because they have her dead to rights. She lied to them. That's perjury. And there's no way that once they make their complaint to the to the Department of Justice coming from the Congress, that they can overlook that. He may have looked at it the other way as he was doing his own investigation, which he put in the hands of an FBI agent who was married to a Virginia politician who was supporting Hillary Clinton and who got $650,000 from the governor of Virginia to run her campaign. That is really corruption right there. The man who's in charge of investigating Hillary Clinton, his wife was a congressional candidate who was being funded by Hillary Clinton through the governor, Terry McAuliffe. So what we have exposed is the most corrupt political party and political system that the world has ever seen. And they were so sure that they could control information as they had from the day that John F. Kennedy was killed. The major networks had filtered the information and had become so adept at doing so that they could practically make Americans think the opposite of the truth was the truth. But that is why I am celebrating that a large proportion of Americans have reclaimed their own individuality, their own consciousness, and their own conscience. Because conscience can be manipulated too. And these people who are ranting out in the street accusing Trump of every Nazi crime committed by Hitler, even before he's taken office, are emotionally disturbed people. And as I've told you, Dr. J, and almost everyone that I've spoken with, been interviewed by on the radio for the last year, the people have been manipulated on an emotional level.
For decades.
And I was struggling for the right words to express what has been done to a large segment of the population that has been put into a state of perpetual anxiety and persistent paranoia. And lo and behold, as I was explaining these ideas and observations to a lawyer friend of mine last Sunday, we sat down and celebrated my birthday a month late.
Mm-hmm.
We watched Harry Palmer movies. The Ipcrest file was on, which I hadn't seen since I saw it first run in the theater.
Me and Johnny were just asking about...
What I call the Ipcresting
Give us a quick rundown on this, because then we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back and talk about that and, of course, revisit JFK.
Yeah, let me just tell the folks.
Sure.
Stay tuned, folks, because you're going to find out what it means to be Ipcrest. The Ipcrest filing of America is going to be revealed in the next segment. And this is how a meme that triggers emotional disturbances in individuals when they hear trigger words to make them violent and anarchistic. So stay tuned, and I'll explain what the Ipcrest filing of America really is.
And everybody, we'll be right back, and I'm glad that Robert just mentioned that, because we do have some much more to talk about, and of course he will definitely be back on very soon to talk about more of this, because this Trump is not going to go away. So everybody stay tuned. Johnny Webb in London, Dr. J, me, myself, and I here in the City of Angels, and our guest live in New York, Manhattan particularly, will be right back.
This is Georgia Tsoukalos, and you're listening to Dr. J Radio Live.
These creatures are very, very strange. They're anomalous.
It is the age of revelations. Bizarre creatures. The false perception of reality.
Of Dr. J's, you know, website, you'll see it on the left hand side. It's like right there. Click the link. You know, guys, what can I tell you? I mean, it's $40, but you get a DVD and a book plus three bonuses, a communion CD, a year subscription to our Politics, Property, and Supernatural magazine, which comes in your email box. Watchers 3, which is $20 for that DVD. Fingerprints of a Supernatural. We promise you, you will not be disappointed. And Dr. J gets a cut of the proceeds. So everybody's happy. You support him, you support us, and it's all good. And you get to educate yourself on what's going on, because we've just scratched the surface here. Trust me.
I'm Richard C. Hoagland, and you're listening to Dr. J Radio Live.
Torpedo impact now, 40 seconds. Torpedo impact, 25 seconds.
Bye. All ahead, Frank. All ahead, Frank.
I'm Art Bell, and you're listening to Dr. J Radio Live.
All right.
Back, of course, to the second segment of Dr. J Radio Live. Like I said, I'm broadcasting from the City of Angels and my trusty co-host, where it is nearing 4 a.m. Greenwich Mean Time, is in his studio in London, England, in the United Kingdom. How cool is that to say? I would rather say that than Los Angeles, California. And of course, we have our guest, the one and only Robert Morningstar, someone who I always turn to for information, always sends me amazing stuff because he is always on the cutting edge. And we both agree on one very vital piece of information, that there's not just a bunch of small conspiracies, there's one big one. And that's the massive part about it. So, Johnny, did you want a couple of comments until Robert is quite back?
Well, yeah, it's just interesting that, you know, that we've got this transition to a new prime president, but like you say, Obama, who's on his way out, he's trying to leave so many sort of
legacy
problems for Obama, for Trump, you know?
And
I'm a bit concerned about that because, you know, we've got so-called transparency of government, so-called, this government coming in to be a new people's government. But we've got the blatant abuses going on, and it's very difficult for me to just, you know, forget that you've got a paramilitarized police that are using tear gas and rubber bullets, and, you know, they're spraying these protesters. There are innocent women, kids, old people. That really disturbs me that is still going on in our modern times.
And I think it's just insane, and for me to be living literally in LA and making it impossible to go do business or work or do anything in the city of LA or Hollywood. And this is happening all over California, San Francisco, Long Beach.
Haven't you? You've got Thanksgiving
Thursday.
Coming up on
That's
Thursday.
Right.
And, you know, it's like the rest of America are going to sit down with Thanksgiving meals and
complain.
The whole idea of Thanksgiving was to celebrate with Indians. Wasn't
yes,
it?
It was sharing another culture, being greeted by another culture, and, you know, the pilgrims at the time were low on food, so they were fighting the tribes of the Indians. And of course, what happened was they came together for a big feast and they finally gained an appreciation for each other's cultures and as people, as each one of them looked at the other and said, this is another person with feelings, ideas, a soul, everything. Sure, he may not look like me or was raised differently, but this is an actual person, and that was the coming together of two very separate people, especially in those days, which, as you know, just in Europe, places that had very slight differences, but for the most part, the same technology, would fight over the stupidest things. But yet, Thanksgiving, like you said, is coming up, where everyone's supposed to come have a peaceful dinner, which is going to be a thanks dinner. And the reason why it lasts for 3 days is because it goes back to the old story in the 1600s. They cooked so much food that it lasted for 3 days. So that's what's supposed to happen. There's supposed to be so much food cooked that literally from Friday, Saturday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, you still eating food. And they even have recipes all online about what to do with your leftover turkey, how to make it into cool sandwiches and all this stuff. It's just really fun and a good time. And then not to mention, we have Black Friday, which the reason they call it Black Friday is because anybody who is an accountant or works in business knows that on your balance sheet, red shows that you're in the negative. Black Friday is the day that so much shopping is done. That is the one day throughout the entire year that it will bring the shopping back to into the black. So that's why they call it Black Friday. Not as a bad thing, like, oh, like a demonizing black or dark night. No, it means it's supposed to be a good thing for businesses. But here's the crazy part, Johnny. What has happened in the last few years? All my life, and I really don't want to divulge my age, but I guess I'm going to, since I'm going to be 37 on Wednesday, a week from tomorrow night. All my life, what you had is Black Friday starting early, 5 a.m., 6 a.m., so on and so forth. But then, a few years ago, they started moving it to midnight, Wednesday night into Thursday morning. Now, you have stores, major department stores and malls opening all of Thursday early. So people, instead of having this peaceful dinner or lunch and dinner and all of the above, instead are shopping. And now, from what I'm seeing from the local commercials, they're even starting earlier than that. It's like before you even get to your Thanksgiving, you're going to get all your Black Friday deals done, and people are literally standing in line. A couple years ago, just out of curiosity, I went with my family to dinner for Thanksgiving at my aunt and uncle's house, who are traditional Greek. So we had Greek food, but we had traditional American Thanksgiving food, which is usually turkey, stuffing, and the, you know, all the goodies, that the trimmings that go along with it, such as fresh cranberry sauce and so on and so forth. And so this was the first year that they had implemented major stores such as Walmart, Target, Best Buy, opening at midnight. Well, we got home about 11:15, and I said, hey, will you go with me? She goes, I'm a little tired. I said, please, we'll leave in 20 minutes. We'll just check it out. I don't have anything I need to buy. Let's just grab whatever we can and get it. So I went into Target, which I took you to, I believe someone took you to when you were here, and we went to the electronics department, and I needed another headset for the radio show years ago, okay? And I found the headset, so I went to stand in line at the electronics section because I realized the line for the store was stretching all the way along. All the way to the electronics section. Then the people at the electronics section where I got in line were pissed off because they said I was cutting in line, that was the actual line for the front of the store. And then I looked to see where the end of that line was, and it had stretched all the way across the store. I mean, literally against the back wall and then to the opposite corner. It was a 4-hour wait. I looked at my $10 headset where I was going to save $2, and I said, bye. And we just left. We're like, I'm never participating in this madness. Anyway, Robert, you back, my friend?
Yeah, I've been back here listening to your Thanksgiving story.
Yeah, isn't it crazy how things horrible. Have changed?
You know what it is? It's, again, it's secularism trying to destroy the spirituality of a holiday.
Exactly.
The beauty of Thanksgiving for me has always been that it's been a spiritual holiday without religious overtones, and that everyone came together in a familial setting to share the feast, to share the bounty. But this is another sign to me of the attempt of secularism to destroy spirituality by distracting us from the true purpose of the day, and by turning people into greedy mobs.
Machines. Oh, yeah, they run over each other. There is not a single year, especially in the last few years, that moved the Black Friday to Thursday night, midnight. Now it's Wednesday, and I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, or Thursday. Now it's Thursday morning before you even go have your peaceful dinner. You're going to be shopping, and there is not one year where someone isn't dying by trampling. Isn't that sad?
This is a perfect example of what I'm going to discuss the IPCRES filing of America.
Yes.
Now, I talked about the mind control apparatus that was installed and how they could First, they could fool us. For the first 20 years, it was intellectual deceptions to fool our brains by fudging the facts, twisting the testimony, and all kinds of things like that. But since the 1990s, and in particular since the Clinton era, it has been more of a kind of thing that I call emotional blackmail in the mass media, putting people into a constant state of anxiety in order to elicit outrage, anger, fear, paranoia that will motivate people to become activists in political causes. Now, I was struggling for this with this vocabulary and telling my friend, as I mentioned earlier, my lawyer friend and I spent Sunday together, and we were watching the first Harry Palmer movie,
yes,
The Ipcress File, and that dealt with an Eastern Bloc nation kidnapping brilliant scientists and then putting them under this program.
Wait,
and
you said Harry
back.
Palmer, not Potter.
Harry Palmer. I'm sorry, did I say Potter?
No. I just wanted to correct for everyone to make sure they heard
Harry
the right.
Palmer.
That's what I heard. P-A-L-M-E-R.
Harry Palmer.
Yeah.
So that was by portrayed by Michael Caine. He was the rival of James Bond.
Ah.
The poor man's 007. No fancy gadgets, no fancy resorts, just... more of a gumshoe.
My name is Michael Caine.
Michael Caine, yes.
Great guy. Great actor, especially in Dark
Knight.
Actually,
friends, I have to say that after seeing this movie for the first time since it was released, I have to say that this has to be one of the greatest, if not the greatest, spy film ever made. And in particular, because of the cinematography. The cinematography is superb. It makes the movie almost three-dimensional.
Really?
They use the foreground, the midground, and the background. It's incredible.
Speaking,
but the key to it is this. This film gave me the words to express what has been done to America, and I call it the Ipcress filing of America. When they subjected someone to the Ipcress treatment, the brilliant scientist would lose the strongest faculty, his science. He would be sent back as apparently a normal human being, but when it came time to function, he became dysfunctional. He couldn't do the work because of the effect of the Ipcress treatment. And what Ipcress stands for is induced psychoneurosis by conditioned reflex under stress. Think about that. Induced psychoneurosis, meaning causing a mental disturbance in someone by conditioned reflex under stress, reinforcing a behavior pattern by subjecting the person to unceasing stress. And this is precisely what I have been describing as the distressful activity of watching the mass media, in particular CNN, MSNBC, all the scaremongering stations, both TV and radio, but in particular, I zoom in on CNN because that's the one that I feel, above all others, has become very adept at emotional blackmail and incitement of fury. And it works like this. One person went to a Trump rally in Chicago and had a fist fight. One person got punched. They caught it on camera. Then they show that one punch for 1,000 times a day for the next 3 days, repeating it. The woman running away from at the Trump rally who was being assaulted by the Democrats who chased her down and cornered her in front of the door and then started pelting her with eggs in the face and the head. They showed that over and over and over and over again. And any number of other instances that are intended to
One that comes to mind, Robert, sorry to interrupt you there, is the particular one where Hillary Clinton is being asked a question and then she rolls her eyes back and her head starts bobbing around.
Yeah,
that's one. Yeah,
hey,
but also the cackle.
Now, the two things I want to say. First of all, I'm sure you saw Hillary Clinton's speech a couple nights ago. That is not the same Hillary that was giving her concession speech the morning after the elections of Tuesday, November 8th, on Wednesday, November 9th. After about 2 a.m. Eastern time or so, John Podesta came out when the Hillary supporters were all long-faced and crying and seeing that they were going to lose. And he said, there's a lot more ballots that need to be counted, so everybody, you've had a long night and spent several months, you know, come we'll continue this tomorrow, come back and Hillary will be here. And that's when she gave her concession speech. But the point was, it just blew me away. Now, the other thing I was going to say is, speaking of older movies, I watched something that Johnny turned me on to years ago, the other day. So this was about the fifth or sixth time I was watching it and paying attention yet again, just to show how ahead they were from our times and how they were showing us what they, I believe it was John Carpenter, knew to be fact long before these people were taking it seriously, which is why they labeled it as a science fiction movie. And that movie was They Live. And that was way ahead of its time. What do you have to say about that, Robert? Is Robert still there? Let's double check.
I'm here. I was just getting rid of a noisy cat.
Oh, no problem. No
Galahad
problem.
Galahad is insufferable. When I'm on a show, he wants to come and listen, and then he starts comments. But yes, They Live is another perfect example of what basically is called subliminal seduction in advertising. The manipulation of your subconscious by print and print content and media, camouflaged images in media. That's basically what it's about, to make you hungry for something you weren't really hungry for, to make you desire a product that you don't really need, to induce beliefs which are unnatural to you, to accept them, to, for fear of being called a bigot. All of these techniques have been very well refined. And it's interesting to note that first, that what I call disinformation technology, this was an in-house science of the Central Intelligence Agency and other government intelligence groups and the military. But the fact is that many, many people over a period of 50 years were initiated and reinitiated into this technology. But then these people would leave the government. And we're here, we talk about lobbyists and all of that. This is where it really becomes important. They migrated out of intelligence and out of the military into industry and into commerce. And with them went that knowledge, that technology of manipulation, of psychological and emotional manipulation. And it was turned to manipulating the individual, as I said, to desire and become hungry for something that they really didn't hunger for, or to desire an object or a possession that they didn't really need, perhaps only as a status symbol, but that in itself, you know, you're not in, you're not cool if you don't have the latest iPhone, you're not cool if you didn't have the Nintendo box, and you're not cool if you don't play Pokemon Go nowadays.
That's right. That's right.
But Pokemon Go, was I on your show telling you about how I ran into a hive of Pokemon hunters? Pokemon Go
in Central Park, right?
In Central Park.
Yes.
And the weird thing was that the body motion, the movement, the crowd motion was not human. It was kind of an insectoid. It was like seeing ants and bugs scurrying over the hills, the rocks, and the field where I observed this. And the other thing was the state of mind that it induced. When I stopped the one player who was approaching me, looking at something in his hand, and it was a Chinese fellow, and I asked him, hey, are you playing Pokemon? And he said, yeah, yeah. He's looking at the screen. And I said, hey, can you show me which one you're hunting or what it is? And he looked up and he had a drunken, delirious look in his face like I've only seen in the eyes of really messed up cocaine abusers, heroin addicts, methadone freaks.
Yes.
The guy's eyes were glazed, and, you know, I could actually see that he had to struggle to pull his mind back out of the virtual reality in which he had been playing to communicate with me in the real reality in which we were living. And then he showed me the Pokemon creature that he was hunting, and I asked him, if one of you catches it, does it disappear for all the other people? And he said, no, there's a lot of them. And I was wondering, what the hell is this whole thing about? So then I walked out of Central Park down the street, and I passed an ice cream shop. And there in the ice cream shop, I saw 10 wanted posters for this little yellow Pokemon creature that the guy had shown me. And I walked up to it and said, so-and-so Pokemon wanted, one free ice cream for turning him in. So the deal is this big commercial enterprise to, you know, to push the sale. And like I said, a product that you don't really want. The person might not want it to have an ice cream cone, but because they caught a Pokemon and there's a wanted poster, they'd go in there and claim their unwanted ice cream just because it's free. But it really isn't free, you know?
Yeah.
So the other part is this. I said to myself, what is the higher purpose of this thing? There's got to be a higher, you know, like a secret agenda. And then I realized, you know, what this is a posse. This is an electronic posse. And it's just one step removed from getting an ice cream cone for this Pokemon to getting a reward for catching some political dissident, a Julian Assange, or somebody that the government doesn't like. They just paste him up like a Pokemon. And if we get down to the point where we have the GPS monitoring or the RFID chip, you know, if the government wants somebody, they just put out a Pokemon dragnet on the person, and 60, 70 people just go jumping out trying to capture the person. So I really see it as a very sinister thing.
Psychological effects on people. You're talking of sinister things, and I recently watched a clip of what looked like the rich and the elite famous eating an effigy of a woman in a cake form. And it was quite sort of scandalous that they're sort of, you know, they're all around chopping up this body and eating it.
And
at the same time, you know, there's this Bista Pizza scandal, this Comet Ping Pong, or what do you make of this, you know, that's bringing into the headlines?
Well, I didn't see that cake, but I can imagine the symbolism of it. It is pretty, terrible. Then there is this, dare I call it a vogue, zombie vogue that came out with, started with the Night of the Living Dead and then has evolved into this zombie culture and this whole fascination, you know, with cannibalism, basically. And that's what you're talking about, is a symbolic cannibalism, to have a big cake shaped like a woman and then start carving in pieces and eating the different pieces. And who gets the pussycat, you know? Yes. Who gets the what?
I don't really want to see the
parts, but who's vying for the lips? It's sick, man. That's all I've got to say. It's a very sick idea, and it's intended to desensitize human beings to common decency and basics of humanity, really. But again, right now, Dr. J, I'm honored you put the webpage up that I'm the guest, and it's the return of a brilliant mind. Yes. But what I'm celebrating is the return of the brilliant mind of America to itself. That is why we should be celebrating. America broke out of the grip of mind control this election and said, hell or high water, I'm not going to believe any of the lies that I know I'm being fed. I don't know how I can explain these polls and these statistics. as I explained them to you today. 67 and 27 is not 100, and 67% vote of a 76% advantage means a loss of 9%, not a win for Hillary Clinton. So people said, I don't believe the lies anymore, and they've matured to the point where they can resist this emotional blackmail, except the ones who have gone zombie, Democratic zombie, that's what I call it, the Portland group in particular. Let me tell you, Dr. J, you asked me about the Trump protest.
Yes.
We don't feel it in New York. Nobody's talking about it.
Except the news.
And you know what? The news, like just like that one punch that I said is shown 1,000 times and make you think it's a riot of 1,000 people, that's a handful of people down in front of Trump Tower. You know? What? A few hundred, then a few thousand? You know, 5,000 people is minuscule in New York. Take a look at Times Square on New Year's Eve when you see 1 million people crowding the streets. What these people are doing is, yes, they're disrupting traffic on Fifth Avenue between 58th and 57th
and
Street.
And Fifth Avenue is where Trump Tower is, right?
That's right. It's right there. And it's a couple of blocks from Central Park. But to be honest with you, the disruption of traffic is greatly, greatly exaggerated. The rest of the city is moving on. But I do have to say that this, having been involved in every election since the Eisenhower election, although I was not a really active participant in the drive for Ike, I was aware of it. But in 1960, I was way in as a pamphleteer and a gopher for the election of President John F. Kennedy. This is the first election in all my life in New York City where I didn't see one single poster. There was not one handout. There was not one car with a loudspeaker going around saying vote for Clinton or vote for Trump. And there wasn't a single debate, discussion. You would go into restaurants. Nobody talked about it. Everybody kept their vote secret. There was only one argument that I heard. It woke me up at 7 o'clock in the morning. It was an argument between two black women. And one black lady was saying to the other one, you get out of here with your Olivia Clinton. And don't talk against my Trump because he's going to whip your ass. So that was the only debate in all the months leading up to this. And it is the strangest election that I have ever experienced in New York. New Yorkers kept mum, and New Yorkers have kept mum afterwards. Nobody really discusses it. Nobody's showing any. And I'll tell you honestly, what I've experienced is the friendliest and happiest African-American neighbors that I have experienced in many years, you know, coming up to us, and my friends in the park.
Here's the problem. Before Obama was elected president, I was in the affluent suburbs of Los Angeles County, Northridge, and I had black friends. And we would carpool together. I had never seen racism in my life until I was actually a victim. I had a friend who's older than me, and she was dating a black gangster guy. And after they got a little high on their weed and drinking on their beers, they started picking a fight with me, calling me cracker, and she suggested it might be a good idea to leave before they beat the crap out of me, because there was, 40 to 1. So I left, but that was the first time in my life I'd actually experienced racism, and it wasn't the other way around. It was they were against me. But never in my life until that point. And I'm talking about you're going through my elementary days, junior high school even, and nobody looked at a black person and said, you're below me. Nobody.
No. New Yorkers are really not that way at all. You know, there is not that issue here. We don't have race riots, you know. We have demonstrations. but they're not racially tinged. Black Lives Matter is not a big movement around here. The people of New York, especially the African Americans here, know that we live in peace and that we are not racist. And I do want to point out something here. A lot of people think that it was black voters that elected Obama. Obama was put in office by white voters who were, in my opinion, exercising what I call a vanity vote. They had been cowed for so long with charges of racism. Well, they decided
Obama
to show,
was
racist.
Approached to be president when he was at California Occidental College. Real quick, Robert, sure. We got a little over 12 minutes to go. I sent you a Skype. I wanted to say we can go hours and hours and hours upon the show. Do you want to do 2 hours a week from tonight, or do you want to do an hour a week from Thursday?
That's up to you. I'll accept the
let's do 2 hours a week from tonight. That way we have a full 2 hour show to continuation to continue these topics, not to mention what's going to happen this weekend.
Yeah which is be a fortune teller, tell me.
Well, more this Trump escalation bashing and everything.
Oh, listen. One thing I do worry about. I worry, and Johnny very astutely observed it. Obama is trying to leave a minefield behind for Donald Trump to navigate.
Yes.
And I am afraid that he is trying to keep pushing and pushing this antagonism with Russia. For me, one of the happiest things in the aftermath of Trump's election was the call from Putin to Trump
to congratulate him.
And I said, oh, thank God. You know what? We just put off World War III.
Correct. Which is what Johnny and Sean David Morton were saying, that if Clinton got elected 6 weeks after her inauguration, we would have been at World War III, which I firmly believe.
I'm hoping that we forestall it. I kept saying on your show and others, in this election, the peace candidate is Donald Trump. But listen to this. What Obama is doing to Putin today is what Khrushchev was doing to Kennedy in 1962. There's a 90-mile gap of water between Cuba and the United States, and Castro and Khrushchev were putting nuclear missiles in Cuba, and that was a casus belli, a cause for war in 1962. Obama has been putting the missiles in Poland, which is contiguous with Russia. There is no 90 miles between Poland and Russia. They touch each other directly. He's trying to do the same thing in Ukraine, and he's trying to do the same thing in Latvia. And I recommend to people, I mentioned it before, Harry Palmer, Michael Caine, the first three movies in 1965, each one of them was warning us about something that is happening to us today. The Ipcress filing of America, induced psychoneurosis by conditioned reflex under stress. The second one was about the smuggling of Nazi war criminals out of the Eastern Bloc and sending them to the West. And the third one, the billion-dollar brain, was a caricature of a Texas oil multimillionaire who was a combination in the character of Lyndon Johnson, H.L. Hunt, and George H. Bush. And what that movie, the third one, was warning us about was that by 1966, the CIA had turned over decision-making away from human beings to artificial intelligence. A computer was making all the global decisions of strategy and tactics for the United States under the direction of a Texas oil man with connections, deep connections to the CIA. And he was trying to start a revolution against the Soviet Union in Latvia. And lo and behold, that is exactly what the scenario is today. They are trying to foment an armed rebellion or an armed attack and hostility with Russia. So Putin He's a smart cookie. He's an excellent chess player. He knows strategy. He knows tactics. And since Obama came out of a bag on him at this most recent meeting that they had, I believe in Peru, Putin has decided to move his nuclear-tipped tactical missiles right up to the Polish and Ukrainian border, because that is the right thing for a good general to do when he's faced with an imminent attack. He's telling you, don't think that you're going to cow or goad Russia into anything. And if you do, expect to suffer the consequences. So it's a very precarious time for all of us. And though I am happy about the outcome and the prospects for the future, we still have to navigate 2 months till the end of Obama-Clinton reign of terror in geopolitics. I would like to say, if I have a minute or two,
sure,
to direct people to UFO Digest, ufodigest.com, and we have a headline article. It's called The JFK Torrent of Truth for 2016, 53 years later, and it's a compilation of articles and songs and films and YouTubes by my dear friend Victor Martinez, with whom I work very closely in getting information out to the public. Victor the Sky Wizard, Victor Martinez, also lives in Los Angeles. And Dr. J, I think if you would, you might get him on your show to talk.
Sure.
He's quite a colorful character, a brilliant fellow, and a good
always
friend.
Always on the lookout for new guests that will
the other guest I'll recommend is Greg Boone, who is one of the top ufologists in my circle. And Greg Boone and I work closely together on articles and investigations. And he's an excellent cartoonist. And Greg has invited me to work with him on his new cartoon. He's a cartoonist, but he is also a specialist in comic books. And he is producing a comic book series and coloring books that are going to be based on crop circles, Syriology. So he asked me to come aboard, and I've agreed. So I want to give a shout out to Greg Boone in Poughkeepsie, New York. He just transplanted from Florida, originally from Poughkeepsie, then to Florida, now back in Poughkeepsie. And he and I worked on an article on the Poughkeepsie Black Triangle UFO that overflew the headquarters of the Poughkeepsie Journal when he worked there in the 1970s. And it was the giant triangular-shaped UFO that came right over the building where he worked, and he ran up to the roof and got a close-up view of it, and it was all over Poughkeepsie, and it may be the same triangle-shaped UFO that overflew the Indian Point nuclear reactor station back in 1984. So I also have a straight news station or news feed called Morningstar News. .nyc. I have a New York City URL. It's not .com or .org. It's Morningstar News, one word, .nyc. And there you can access the CNN Can, the Fox Box. You can access my radio interviews with Scott Teeters on Far Out Radio. And soon, other friends like Dr. J, you're welcome to compile our shows together, and I'll give you a page of Morningstar News.
Absolutely.
All the YouTubes. So I'll put up a page, Robert Morningstar with Dr. J. And tomorrow night I'm going to be on with Michael Vara on Late Night in the Midlands at 9:30. And hopefully I'll see Richard Hoagland.
It settles that a week from tonight you're going to do 2 hours.
Yeah. I'd like to say also hello to Richard Hoagland. Because the last time I was on politics, you know, you're good friends, but Richard Hoagland kicked me off the show because a lady guest of his called Trump a racist. Okay, that was fine with me. But then she said, Trump doesn't want to turn America great again. Trump wants to turn America white again. And that really peed me off, honestly, because that is really going way too far. So I told her that whenever you point the finger of racism at anyone, when you point the index finger of racism at anyone, three fingers point back, and that she was the racist and the self-hating white, anti-white, the bigot. So Richard got upset. He wanted me to apologize, and I said no. And he said, I'll have to take you off the off the council, whatever, the staff, the panel. And I said, no, I'm not going to apologize because that's what she said and that's what I think. And he said, okay, click. So we had a falling out. And I've lost a couple of other friends over this election. But hopefully we can mend fences and be friends again before the next election. So anyway, folks, don't take this thing too seriously. Don't go overboard. There is a life after Hillary Clinton. And it's probably going to be a good life under Donald Trump. Let's just give the guy a chance, all right? And don't blame everything that's going on now on him. He's not even in office. The Dakota pipeline mess is Obama's mess, okay?
Yes.
He's the one who sent the federal troops into the Dakota sacred lands. He's the one that sent the federal troops to kill Levon and arrest the Bundys in Oregon. He's the one that sent the federal troops down to the Bundy Ranch where they had the standoff. And I'm very proud of my fellow Americans who have stood up against this tyranny. And we have saved the Constitution of the United States in this election.
During that time at that ranch in Nevada, we actually had a host on the scene, and he was describing what was going on, and he was also getting at some of the militiamen saying, no, you're not going to take away our land. We've been here long before you even put up fences, etc., etc. Yeah. So things are very, very corrupt, my friend. Very corrupt.
Dr. J, I want to say one more thing. I want to tell your audience what a hero you are. You're doing a show under great duress, and I want people to know that you have done this show under a lot of pain, and that's the reason that maybe you're not sounding as well. You're sounding sharp, but your speech is slurred from the painkillers, and I want people to know that that's the reason. And I thank you for having me on, and
we still got 10 more minutes, so I still want to talk about, of course, okay, so obviously we're going to talk more about Trump and about Hillary, because that's not over. It's not going to be over at all, literally, till December 19th when the Electoral College appoints him as president, and then inauguration on January 20th when there are going to be worldwide protests. It's going to take some time.
There's a lot going on. It's not over.
Yes.
And it's still dangerous. I'll tell the public now. Last week, Lou Dobbs on Fox News Financial tried to warn the nation that there is a snake in the grass moving around trying to still trying to undo Donald Trump. And there are two things moving around, two suggestions. There's one group of people trying to coerce or convince electors to vote against Trump, even though they are committed to do it. Some are being coerced and threatened to change their vote and to vote for Hillary Clinton on the pretext that she won a popular vote. I think that's complete BS. The other one is a group of congressmen, both Republicans and Democrats, who are forming a cabal trying to find reasons to impeach Donald Trump before or after.
That's right. That's right. Especially about the tax returns.
About the what?
Tax
returns. Oh, the tax returns.
Yeah.
Well, that's a rather insignificant thing.
And then,
point.
As you know, he already settled with Trump University for $25 million.
Yeah.
So,
but as far as the financial disclosure, Donald Trump has complied with every legal requirement demanded by the Federal Election Commission to be a candidate and now president-elect, and handing out his income tax form was not one of those requirements. He filled out the financial disclosure forms, and that's all that he has to do. So if he waits until his second term to disclose his finances, fine with me. He has complied with the law, and no one should be required to provide more than the law requires. That's my take on it. As they say in The Warriors, leave the kid alone. One of my favorite lines in that great movie.
Johnny, any comments?
Yeah, guys, I'd like to end the show tonight because I think Dr. J's medicine's kicked in and it's not fair, you know. We're trying
to... Yeah, I had serious root canal today, and I really wish I had more topical anesthesia to kick in so I can... yes, I will be drooling and numb on my left side, but I wouldn't be feeling this deplorable pain that is, you know, with all the needles that he was sticking in there to, of course, put the anesthesia. And on top of that, we also have the, the drilling and the temporary cap, which is the second temporary cap, which means in 2 weeks from Friday, I'm going to have a regular cap, which, by the way, these are disgustingly priced. Disgusting. You have no idea. I don't want to say on air what it cost, but it was a lot of money for one tooth. And I have four more crowns to go and six cavities to go. So you're looking at $15,000 easily. Easily.
Yeah. I hope you're covered.
Yeah.
Well, November 22nd is a day of pain and suffering. And so it's very little compared to what President Kennedy went through.
Here, I do have a couple questions for you here. Let me read them to you. This is Josh Blantz, Minnesota. Did he say screwed up his life by going to law school? Oh, no, that was the other night. Hold on, let me see. Okay, this is tonight. Ellen DiStefano, Delaware. What will Trump do for the economy?
Oh, I think he's already done marvels for the economy.
Yes.
You remember, just like as he did for Brexit, there was a doom and gloom meme being planted that if Britain withdrew, you know, the world markets were going to crash and the pound was going to hit bottom and the end of the world would be upon us. Well, it didn't happen. The same thing was predicted if Donald Trump won. And on the night that he was winning, the market dropped 800 points. And as soon as he won, it recovered, and that market is now at the highest levels that it's ever reached. Donald Trump is the only president that I know who has the business acumen and the college training in economics.
Which is why he turned down the presidential salary of $400,000 a year, and by law he has to take some payment, which is going to be a dollar. I'd like to see
congressmen do that too.
All
federal officials, because the federal bureaucracy has grown so great that it is consuming so much and so many of our natural resources and our national resources, and imposing regulations that are killing businesses.
Yes.
One of those regulations was Obamacare. I predicted when Obamacare was going to be passed. I fought it tooth and nail every step of the way. And I said, if they do this, businesses
fail. Trump part-time mention jobs that in the video today?
I have no idea. I didn't hear the video. I've withdrawn from the mass media. I spent 17 months every day, 10 hours a day, looking forward to the election. And after the election, I just stood back. And you know what? I can't stand more than 30 seconds, 45 seconds of going back to monitoring. I don't watch. I monitor CNN, MSNBC, CNBC, Le Journal. I watch French news. I recommend that highly, folks.
RT. RT and
or RT.
BBC.
I don't get that on my cable set. But,
I talking of French news, you know, I see Le Pen, the French lady in France, are looking that she's going to be elected on a very similar exit, like Brexit, a bit like, you know, the turnaround of Trump.
Election. Marie Le Pen. Marie Le Pen.
And so it's looking like this seems to be a trend with government swapping. I sort of predicted that this would happen while I was in America, and I'd seen it from the Britex and how interested Americans were with Britex. And it sort of seemed, and Donald Trump said that he didn't spend any of his own money on the campaign or didn't take contributions for a campaign. But what he was saying was is he didn't need to because he was looking at the way the markets were on trends, and it's using internet. It's not using multiple monies. It's just using a very simple service, which is the internet. And that's how his campaign run, on live news of trends of what's going on the net, rather than whatever system they've used in the past. And that's what saved a lot of money. But with that trend, he realized that this Britex system of getting away from government and corporate government and militarized government and getting back to government for the people. And that's what's been the clear message.
Yes, that's what the founders of the United States said they wanted to do. But look what has happened. Corruption. It's off the wall, fellas. Yeah. Off the wall. Okay, I have another question here. Okay, let me read it to you. This is Walt Harmon, Connecticut. Are American tech workers going to finally be able to get jobs that are now going to non-American citizens? That's a good question. Such as tech, you know, questions like when I call Best Buy, I'm transferred over to India or Pakistan.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Well, I think that he's going to corral all of those corporations, and it is a common fact that major companies. One of the few exceptions is Hewlett Packard, by the way. When you call Hewlett Packard, and I really like that company, you get American savvy, and you don't get shifted to a phone bank in Delhi, or Pakistan. I think that Trump is going to rein that in, but you know what? American workers have to educate themselves to be better, to be as good. Because I'll tell you. You know, just because they're from India doesn't mean that we're smarter.
They are
very disciplined people. They are really brilliant programmers.
6 days a week in school.
But the other thing is America has to let loose its own imagination. The individual person has to reinitiate his own incentive.
We're
to
lazy.
Invent. You've got to be, you're lazy. You've got to be like Steve Jobs and Bill in his younger days, Bill Gates, when they were working, tinkering in the garage. Go back to your garage, start inventing something, think of a business that you conceive a business on the internet, do your programming, set up your website, get your product, get off your ass and start working for yourself. That's the only way you're going to get anywhere here, not on a salary from anybody else's dole, you know?
Agreed.
So that's what I say. You know, self-reliance.
That's why after
Another
law
thing
school.
I want to say is they have been very successful at planting a meme in Americans that has made us reflexively anti-nationalist and pro-globalist. That the idea that nationalism is bad and globalism is good. Well, nationalism is bad depending on what nation you belong to.
Yes.
Okay? But if nationalism is American nationalism, which is not a color-coded nationalism, it's red, white, and blue.
Yes.
It's not black and white.
Yes.
Nationalism is good depending on the country of nationality. Okay? Globalism is not an answer to anything. The chaos that is unfolding across the world today is a result of the drive for globalism under the United Nations, under things like TPP, which I thank God that Trump is rejecting, and Obamacare, gun control, militias, foreign militias here. It's, we have reclaimed our country. Now let's rebuild it. We have dodged a bullet that we don't know how bad that bullet was going to be. And that would have been a Clinton addendum to the debacle of the Obama administrations. So thank God Donald Trump won. I have said it before, I'll say it again. Donald Trump is the John F. Kennedy of our times. And if John F. Kennedy were alive today, he would not be a member of the Democratic Party. He would not be a member of the party that conspired to kill him and locked elbows with Lyndon Johnson and all other president gatekeepers after him to hide the truth that Lyndon Johnson was killed by the Democratic Party and who exploited his death for every whit of power that they could garner, for in meshing us in perpetual warfare, in squandering our youth in Vietnam, squandering the national treasure, and then setting up 50 years of lies thereafter. We broke out of it this year.
Yes.
Be happy for that.
I agree.
And those of you who are still disgruntled, get over it. Go eat some turkey. Have a happy Thanksgiving. And as the Muppets said at the end of their first movie, the Cookie Monster comes out and he says, "Go home! Go home!" That's what I say to the Trump protest.
Here's
home, have some turkey.
One more question before we go. There's been massive, and I mean massive, earthquakes around the globe, except for California. We even had another one at Fukushima yesterday.
Yeah.
Now, there was no leaking of radiation into the ocean. However, these earthquakes are getting bigger. 8.8, 9.2, 7.8. I have never in my entire life seen or even heard about earthquakes this big. And the San Andreas Fault is supposed to erupt every 150 years. The last time it erupted was 450 plus years ago. So not only are we due, we are way overdue. It should have erupted three times by now. So,
well, Dr. J, I'm glad you brought this up because I am greatly concerned, not about the San Andreas Fault, but I'm concerned about next spring, I think it's in May, and the New Madrid Fault. On a certain day in May, there's going to be a complete solar eclipse over Tennessee. That's going to be the point of totality. And I have been tracking a phenomenon for many years, which is that solar eclipses trigger earthquakes.
Yes,
they trigger earthquakes right over the point of totality, but the effect goes right through the center of the Earth to the other side of the Earth and will affect the other side of the Earth with earthquakes at the same time. So this moment of totality is supposed to occur over Tennessee and Kentucky, right over the New Madrid fault line. And I'm forewarning my friends as a precaution, be ready for next spring for a big shakeup in the Mississippi Valley and in the New Madrid fault area. Tennessee, Kentucky, Missouri, and fracking hasn't helped. Fracking triggers earthquakes.
Yes,
this was discovered back in 1967 by the U.S. Army when they started exploring the ideas of fracking by injecting water into oil reserves to force the oil up. And remember, oil is a lubricant. So when you push a lubricant between two surfaces, what happens? The surfaces become slippery. So it was then discovered that the U.S. Army triggered earthquakes in Colorado in 1967, and this was one of the consequences of what is now called fracking. And that is why Oklahoma is shaking like a hula dancer, if you pardon the expression. So I am concerned about next spring in the the New Madrid fault area in the central United States. And let's keep an eye on that.
Yes.
And let's pray for the San Andreas Fault to stay where it is.
So let me say, obviously we're continuing 1 week from tonight, 2 hour show, right?
Right.
Okay. So
okay.
Before I ask you to plug in your website, Facebook, everything else, is there any final statements you want to make on the topics we talked about tonight?
Well, yes, I would just like to say tonight is the anniversary of one of the greatest tragedy America suffered in the 20th century, and that was the untimely loss of President John F. Kennedy. We can only imagine what the world would have become if he had lived. And I can say this from the bottom of my heart, that none of us is the person we would have been if John F. Kennedy had lived. I am happy to have lived in his time. I cherish his memory. And I am happy to see this day. And there are better days coming from our country. If we work together, put aside our differences, and work together for the common good, we're going to have happy Thanksgivings till the end of time. That's
agreed.
All I like to say. Agreed.
I like to say. And that's why the next 4 years are critical, so he can get reelected. And by the way, did you know, this is just another a point I wanted to make. Vladimir Putin is going to stay in power till 2024, and he has 8 years to figure out how to bend the Constitution in his favor, so that way he literally dies in office. He will leave the office of the Kremlin feet first. He will not give up that power. With the billion-dollar home, oligarchs that are kicking him down money for him and his family, it's just sad because KGB, 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 now FSB, FSB, FSB.
Mm-hmm.
What do you have to say about that?
Well, if I could just change.
Go ahead, Johnny, go ahead.
As you were talking like that, what came to mind was I heard that Angela Merkel, the German chancellor leader, she's applying for another 3 or 4 years as well. I mean, how long do these people go on? Are there not people around the world in their countries that could do a better job or at least be elected? Why do we keep seeing the same faces not wanting to leave?
They go on until people wake up in their countries and break out of their own mind control. Germans are some of the most mind-controlled people on every level that I have ever known. It's really hard to break through to them. They have become reflexively socialist. They don't know that any other possible way of living or governing can exist. I don't see how they can't relate to a republic. You know, democracy is one thing, a republic is another. Our Constitution designated our country and our form of government as a republic, which is a representative democracy. Another thing about democracy, and they think that majority is the important thing, a very wise man named Jean Cocteau, a very famous writer and playwright and filmmaker, who made a movie called Beauty and the Beast, said a very important thing. He said this: the majority is not the truth. Right? So when you look at polls and opinions, the majority opinion is not the truth. Remember that. There's a difference between majority and truth. Consensus and truth.
Yes.
Truth often has no consensus at all. And one prime example is Einstein. Came out in 1905 with his relativity theory, and he was excoriated. He was ridiculed. And it took until 1919 for the proof to come in after a solar eclipse showed that he was right about the bending of light passing by the sun, by the gravitational field of the sun, that his theory was proven. So his idea was true, but yes, it was not accepted. And so remember, majority is not the truth.
So with that being said, again, a week from tonight, we are doing part two of Robert Morningstar and, of course, these very, very important topics. I want to thank, of course, Johnny Webb in London, where it is almost 5 a.m. Greenwich Mean Time, where it is now 9 p.m. Pacific Time. And for Robert, almost midnight. Join us again, as we will do next week, and it'll be a full-out show. I won't be coming home from Rue Canal, which really sucks today, because now I can feel all the pains and aches, and as I was saying to Robert earlier, I just, maybe I should have asked to have the local anesthesia go on longer. I didn't want to because I didn't want to have problems talking and drooling when I was drinking water, but at the same time, I wouldn't be, just dying in my left bottom two teeth on the back. But one shattered and one was filling. Yeah.
I want to leave one more tease. I want people to go over to UFO Digest and, yes, read the JFK Torrent of Truth. And kudos to Roger Stone and all his work in exposing Lyndon Johnson. But I want the tease is this. The second article on the left-hand column is from the UK Express. A lot of people don't know the UK Express newspaper. Published an article about a week and a half ago, and it said that Trump's helicopter was tailed by a UFO while it was flying over Iowa.
Really?
So, yeah, and someone took a picture of Trump's helicopter flying over the crowd at one of those Iowa fairs where he addressed the public, and he captured a strange, black, dark, cloudy object tailing it. So I did a photo analysis of that, and you can pick it up. It's called "Trump was tailed by Trump helicopter tailed by UFO." And thank you for the UK Express for the lead on that story. And
I
was watching RT the other day, and Obama was coming into Berlin in Tegel Airport in Germany. And the camera was set up and rolling just before he'd arrived, and so it was still rolling, the camera. And they were showing these army German troops that were going to be standing there on the red carpet as he comes through. And as the plane came in on the tarmac, there was a very fast mover. It was like a little white dot that spread like a line, and it just came shooting across the sky. And I thought to myself, well, that's not a plane coming in as a sort of like a guard for the plane. Yeah. You know, I thought that was strange, but it's available on RT.
Oh, I'll have to check it out. If you can send me the link, I'd appreciate it.
We do have a great friend, Stephen D. Kelly, who volunteers on the show for social media, who is a regular guest on RT. He does at least once a week a 30-minute segment on Russia Today. So,
he's also on Press TV.
Yes, yes, yes. So, with that being said, everybody, tomorrow night we will take a slight break on Trump, except because our guest is also in Manhattan. We will ask him about Trump. We are going to our roots and talking about alien abduction with Adam Ambrose. Thursday being Thanksgiving is night off. Monday night, the 28th, we have the one and only Linda Moulton Howe. And as you know, Tuesday, we do have, of course, Robert Morningstar for 2 hours or longer, if you want to go, brother. You know, the more information, the better. People really look up to you, and you have changed people's minds for the better. Make sure you check out Dr. J Radio Live. That is drjradiolive.com. And that is the same name for every social media account. All you have to do is just Google it, and it will tell you our schedule. we release our guests the night before the shows. So if you want to know what's going to happen after Robert and after, on Thursday, then just the secret is with us. But the point is, you guys will know. So now you know the next few guests. And remember, Dukakis said as soon as Hillary was going to be elected, because he was 110% sure he was going to come back and do a 2-hour interview talking about Hillary. But now I could just see his, envision him with his eyes puffy, his wife crying that, you know, their puppet Hillary did not win. But nonetheless, we have an outsider in. And right before I go, let me remind people of something insane. Nirvana, you remember Kurt Cobain when he committed suicide in 1994? Well, before he died, he said, if you want to get rid of the corruption in Washington, D.C., where you're going to need an outsider to be POTUS, President of the United States. And the POTUS is going to have to be someone like a billionaire who can afford to place the ads, run the campaign and the primary, everything, considering like Bill and Hillary Clinton were getting money. For instance, Johnny Webb was here in Los Angeles, and it just so happens to be that that same day where I had a surgeon appointment in, of course, Beverly Hills, and who was visiting that day? Hillary Clinton. Why? So she can get an award for Benghazi. Benghazi.
Oh, God.
Yes, yes. And it was a $10,000 plate dinner, and she was also receiving a $15 million donation, a charitable donation. So I was just blown away. I was like, people, did you forget what happened in Libya just a few short years ago, where so many people were injured and 4 people were killed, and one of them being Ambassador Chris Stevens? So,
Dr. J, don't forget to tell him what Cobain said. The punchline, come on.
The punchline, yes. So, Cobain said that we are going to need an outsider to come in. The outsider is probably going to be a billionaire. Someone like Donald Trump. Now, this was said in the early 90s. 90, 91, 92, 93, no later than 94. So his prophecy came true. That is who is president-elect, Donald J. Trump. He is up there right now, and it's just a shock to this world, So many world leaders have spoken to Trump, and of course he has also reached out to those who haven't spoken to him. All 22 or 23 celebrities in the U.S. that said they were going to leave the U.S. if Trump was elected are now all saying, oh, we were joking, oh, my family's here, I can't leave, and they're all making excuses. Basically, crybabies, if you want to use a nicer word, because they threaten things and then they don't get their way, and what happens? They turn around and take away that threat they made. Yeah. Not one of those celebrities is leaving the USA. And I thought that's funny. And so, yes.
George Clooney?
I don't know if he was on the list, but you can Google it. Just Google lists or list of celebrities who were going to leave if Trump was elected. You'll see pictures, names, and everybody.
Well, one that stood out for me was Robert De Niro.
Oh, Whoopi Goldberg. Whoopi Goldberg,
yeah. So rude that he was saying it towards the president, you know, nominee. That stood out for me because I liked Robert De Niro, and I thought as an actor that he should be a bit more respectful, especially when it comes to people around the world who know him for what he is. All right, yeah, he's a foul-mouthed person, but, I mean, you're talking about someone that was not even elected at that time, and the abuse given was unbelievable. And that's just one name. So, yeah, there are a lot of famous people that did say they were going to leave. Go on, guys. Jog on.
Yes, absolutely, everybody. So remember, again, part two of JFK assassination, which will literally be a week from the day because today is the anniversary. And then we're going to talk more about Trump and of course the Ipras filing of the of the United States of America. Much more to be said. Everybody stay tuned. Check out drjradiolive.com and our archives for free for you to watch, of course, on YouTube. We have been behind on them, and they will be pushed on up much sooner. So you will get the show after it airs on all the other four networks. And then, of course, on iTunes and Shoutcast. And then, of course, you will all have a chance to hear it on demand with some cool eye candy with Robert's picture and mine, and solar system slideshow going on in the background. With that being said, Johnny Webb, thank you so much for staying awake till 5 a.m., buddy. I appreciate it. And Robert, you are always an amazing guest. You are one of the few that I told Johnny about that no two shows are ever alike. And I love how when I first spoke to you that you said, there's not a bunch of conspiracies. There is one. One big lie. Because the more I look into it, that's what I find. And that is disgusting. That is disgusting. But the more we chip away from it, the more we wake people up, the more we're getting there. And the fact that four independent stations have approached us and said, can we play your shows? And I said, yeah, and that's just great. So right now, 27 states in the United States are carrying the show on FM, mostly FM and some AM. And, of course, you could hear it on, of course, our website, drjradiolive.com, live. And then you could hear it on PSN, Late Night in the Midlands, Deprogram Radio Network, and our newly founded network, thanks to Johnny Webb, Pulse Radio Network, which is in the United Kingdom. And I'm still working on the network in Spain, as well as the network in Australia. So that way we can get all those people who reach out to us during the shows and ask questions. So with that being said, make sure you follow Robert Morningstar's material. Robert, do you have a website?
UFODigest.com.
Exactly.
I also have the UFO Spotlight on WordPress.com and MorningstarNews.nyc. And if people want to write to me, Robert.Morningstar@gmail.com. Very mysterious email address.
Yeah, I know, right? I know. Yeah, yeah. You should actually, you know, I signed up my first email the same way my first dot my last at Gmail. But it turns out I have an email address of just my first and last name at Gmail. So check that out, because you may actually have that if you open your account in, say, 2006, 2007. Basically when smartphones became the norm. So check it out for me as a favor, buddy. Everybody, I really hope you enjoyed the show as much as we did, and we will do part two with the one and only Robert Morningstar. Again, I want to thank Tom Schaefer, who is not on air, Lou Shan, for all the research he does for our show, and of course, Johnny Webb, who is awake late this night to do the shows, and of course, edits them and puts them in the other networks. Not to mention, of course, he's always on the shows before, during, and after. So he deserves a lot of credit. And, of course, Tom Schaefer, who I mentioned, who does the websites, OBS, and people who I have not named that are volunteers and interns. So I want to thank you all, but the most important people that need to be thanked are you, the listeners. Remember, disclosure is in your hands. Please take this information, do whatever you need to vet it, to believe it, and then spread the information. Use your skills, whatever skill set God has given you, and use it. And spread the information, because we're not going to get, as I always say, disclosure or the truth. Who has ever gotten the truth from the president since George Washington? Nobody. So the only way it's going to happen is when more than one half of the percentage, more than 50% of the population of the earth believes without a doubt that not only are there planets that are populated with intelligent species, but they are constantly visiting here. Then you're going to start to see mass sightings and finally landings and cooperation between each other. And as we last know from John Lear and Carrie Cassidy and so many other people, there are upwards of 250, if not 300 different species from extraterrestrial, ultra-dimensional, and so much more that come and visit us. Interdimensional as well. It's just insane. So that's why I'm excited about tomorrow, so we can hear about one person's lifelong being taken in front of school children, teachers, and everything else with lots of witnesses. That's what I like about this the most. And remember, thank you guys for listening. Thank you guys for tuning in. And my heart goes out to you all. And this is Dr. J, and we are officially signing off.
We have an unidentified flying object.
I'm Jack Osborne, and you're listening.
This is Hudson Hamming, and you're listening to.
I'm Richard C. Hoagland, and you're listening to.
I'm Art Bell, and you're listening to Dr. J Radio Live.
We have an unidentified flying object.